eight. So there were a couple of those requirements that just carry forward through the years. So if we go this way, there will be one notice for draft permits, and that'll be a local paper. Again, we would be following the strict requirements of Regulation 18. There are a few other words on who we send permits to. Where they duplicated Reg 8, we just got rid of it. We didn't want to duplicate in case there was confusion. And there was a provision that we sent in 19 that we sent minor source permits to EPA. We don't. They don't want them. It probably was a carryover when there was no Title V and they wanted to see MSR permits, which we do send them, which is a requirement. So we just took that section out. Some other changes that might affect permitting. Like I said, the visible emissions and the upset reporting were merged as best we thought. We don't think it changes anything, but some of the words are a little bit different, and some of the ways they wrote it were a little bit different. We think it's the same language, and we don't think there are any practical changes. We added a definition for working days and changed, there were a few instances of business days, so we changed to working. Don't think it changed anything. If you looked at the top five regs, they actually had both definitions, both words there with no definition. So we just kind of aligned it to one. We combined, there was federally regulated air pollutants and regulated air pollutants, so we just put them all into one. And as we read it, they were the same definition, so we just made them one. And it just took the time to update the definition of VOC at this point. And that's what I picked out as permit issues. Like I said, we try not to change anything if we couldn't, but at this time we tried to make things a little bit better without, you know, affecting the permits. So I guess take questions now and later. Is there any permit questions? Okay, thank you.
My name is Jim Starling. I'm a air inspector working out of West Memphis Field Office. Been there 10 years now, and I didn't really have anything to do with much of this, but I did have a little input on the state of the covering, since Crittenden County was the only county that was affected by it. We'll talk a little bit about the history of the rule and the in Crittenden County's history with the rule, the importance of the changes in the rule itself, and some changes. The rule was adopted in 2004, applies only in non-attainment areas of low growth zone, was actively enforced in Crittenden County upon adoption until 2010, and again between 2012 and 2016. Currently, there are no non-attainment areas within Arkansas. We'll talk a little bit about Crittenden County. This was the, they were non-attainment in 1997, low zone next. Eight-part pavilion, and so 2008 was on that, set by the park pavilion. And as of June 3rd, 2016, they were back in attainment. During that time, both piers there had a gradual rollout. This was before my time, 2004. 2004, but a gradual rollout with information disseminated through the Arkansas Oil Market Association to affected facilities and surveys performed to assess surveys by planning section and make compliance. I said I wasn't there, but performed to assess the compliance status of the facility in Creighton County. They went through and did the regulated storage tanks records to get a, try to get a good list of what was over there to start with. And they spent some time the next couple of years getting all the facilities information on this and trying to figure out which way we're going to. So plant inspection started in 2006, focusing mainly on actually having a stable vapor recovery system at first, and then it progressed during that time. First time non-attainment, and second from to maintenance and testing of the systems. Now I think even 2000 went back into non-attainment the second time. There were still some facilities, a couple that didn't even have a stable vapor recovery. I'm going to check the notes real quick to prepare myself. I was going to mention that, like I said, I started April 21st, 2008 over there. Didn't have any background in this. And then on May 28th, had two inspector supervisors and an inspector come over. We did stable vapor recovery inspections. So I got into it pretty quick off both feet. I wrote down three things I remember mainly from those first inspections I went on that kind of leads to why some of the stuff needs changes now. I was told an independent small business market gasoline was a bulk plant, and that was wrong. The regulation required to have a vent pressure vacuum valve on the vent line. And I found out after that first year going to other inspectors that we didn't really know for sure what one was, because there were several that had just weather heads on top. And we just looked at it, it looked just like a pressure valve, except for it didn't have a label on it. So we walked on through. And one was, we had two different types of systems we were looking for, dual point and coaxial. And coaxial was where you have both lines going to the same tube, and we didn't, the person I was with didn't really know what a coaxial system was, so we called the coaxial system on some of these that didn't have anything in that first year that I was in. But things are a lot clearer now. But I wanted to just mention a little bit about past concerns of the Quebec community. This was a slide around 2014. When they were looking at updating the NACs, and it was a possibility of even going out to 60 parts per billion. And this was put out, I said, by American Petroleum Institute. I got this from their website at the time, and just, I'm not sure what all the data they used to get this, because some of the stuff is not monitors and Arkansas, so these red spots, but I guess they were expecting the counties around the expecting to maybe possibly even be able to want the counties around the infected counties to also go, be part of this, going to non-attainment. But we're all past this right now, and we're down a note here that right now the department has sent in to the EPA for the required information for 2013-15 for these monitors. Everything's below the next point. The 70 parts per billion that it is now, the 2015. It's just a little, and this was just 4 years ago that we were, a lot of us were worried about this, and it could come down the pipe again sometimes, depending on who's in the administration. Talk a little bit about the importance of the regulation. It produces the volatile organic compounds, the precursor to formation of ozone in non-attainment areas. The ground level ozone is pretty serious health effects, effects on our people that, especially those that, at-risk groups such as children, older adults, people who are active outdoors, and on top of that, with lung disease. It gets severe enough out there that stuff like that can, ozone can lead to death of some of these folks. Also, well, they have here, but it also affects the vegetation. So if you're in that area, this, this, farming community, it may affect the yields too, as far as that goes. So the importance of the revision help clarify the regulation for both the state and the regulated community and ensure the maximum benefits of reducing VOCs and prevent future non-attainment diseases. This is previous compliance pitfalls. The throughput definition required records of fuel dispense, while some facilities only kept records of fuel delivered to the gasoline storage tank. Back then, we dealt with a lot of, what we still do, or we did, still did until we went back to containment, but we dealt with a lot of smaller facilities that were subject to the rule. It had to be checked out to keep records to show, at least to show that they were exempt, and a lot of these didn't. Wasn't used to keep up, you know, like a gas station station had their sales record, what went out. Some of these just had records of what they put in the tank, and anybody at the facility used it, they would keep up with it. So now that's, I think that's, this change was revisions. There was no guidance on facility responsibilities when claiming exemption. Again, just a list of exemptions. And it really tell you what you had to do to prove it or anything. It's just a list of exemptions, and we pretty well had to interpret it ourselves to do that. One of the biggest ones I wrote down, the note here was independent small business market of gasoline. There was there's a lot that go into trying to prove that to ADQ, and it didn't really have no guidance in it. We did it in the world. We in 2015 compliance and air compliance and legal produced an affidavit and a worksheet calculation worksheet to help facilities who wanted to try to claim to claim that they were would meet the exemption of being independent small business market of gasoline if they were below 50,000 gallons. But that's changed some too in the draft. No requirements for a public vapor recovery adapter valve to be covered by a vapor tight cap. It's not a biggie, but these public valves are supposed to be self-sealing, and there's no mention in the regulation about having to have a cap on it. But if they haven't got a cap on it, the pocket valve exposed to the elements, dirt, water, and their usefulness will probably not be very long. If you go in there and everything looks good that day, but if it stays like that, open like that, it wouldn't probably be very useful down the road. And also, they were all pretty much, when you buy them new, because I've had some folks buy them while I was doing inspections, and they all came with a cap, dust cap on me. So we think that's been updated. Unclear test methods for the stationary gasoline storage tanks. We had a few lines of information on how to test these, but didn't really go into great detail. There was no backup documentation for it, or nothing to help you along to follow it well. And it was kind of spread out too. You had to go from the rules to the definition back in, of course, kind of the CFR anyway. They go back and forth. And it was similar to Method 21. It just didn't call it anything. It didn't call it EPA reference test method. Unclear phasing process for independent small business marketers. And this was mainly because it gave a percentage of how many how much you had to have compliance of your facilities if you was independent small business working gasoline. And I remember one case came in, was first they had one facility, so he looked at it as having to have just have his facility in compliance in 3 years instead of the first year. So there was some confusion there. There's no defined testing protocols. They had a few things. You had to have an annual test. You had to, I think within 15 days, a felon test, retest, and that's about it. There wasn't much guidance. I will say the compliance at I can't remember what year we did that. I think it was probably in 2013 or 14. We came up with a guidance document for that also to give to folks that it was subject to this. So these spitballs took time and resources away from the main personal information, which was to move an affected non-attainment area in the direction of being reclassified attainment for the ozone mass, and improving both the environmental health concerns and the ability of the area to grow economically. I think I don't know all the rules on that, but there's limitations on what you can do in a non-attainment area as far as getting industry to come there. The purpose of the changes was to clean up typographical errors and redundant language, clarify testing, record keeping, and reporting requirements, and address inconsistencies with NESHAP 6C. Some of the minor changes was, like all instances of rule that I mentioned, were changed to this chapter when referencing this regulation. They had one where the applicability section there, they mentioned gasoline dispensing facility at the first of it. In the second part of it, they call it gasoline distribution facility. And I think that might have been part of what led to some incompliance, thinking that independent small business market was a bulk plant, because distribution seemed like something a bulk plant would do. So got rid of that and got that back to saying the same thing in the same section there. Change some wording to match up with NESHAP 6C, such as delivery vessel to change it from delivery vessel to gasoline delivery vessel. Major changes was just trying to line up with 6C here. We had our exemption for tanks with a capacity of not more than 550 gallons that had submerged fill pipes. Well, NESHAP 6C exempted all tanks below 250 gallons, and then if you went to the next level of needing submerged fill pipe, you had to have anything over that. So we just took out the needing the submerged fill pipe for this exemption. Just change it to just needing a 250 gallon. If it had less than 250 gallon tank, then you weren't set to the rule. It'd be kind of hard to do 10,000 gallons a month out of a 250 gallon tank. Definition of throughput. Amount of gasoline dispensed at a facility, that was the definition, and the draft definition is a total volume of gasoline that is loaded into or dispensed from all gasoline storage tanks at each gasoline dispensing facility during the month. And this falls more in line with NESHAP 6C's, the way they look at the record. You can have either the total amount going in or the total amount going out to use for your throughput record. Yeah, just the going out as the original definition in the chapter stated. Other definition changes, removed definition of gasoline service station, and that was also removed. First part of the rule mentioned, as far part of being subject to this regulation was gasoline service stations and gasoline dispensing facilities. The definition of, we had the rule for a gasoline service station was that it was a gasoline dispensing facility. The only thing extra added was it was sold gasoline instead of just dispensing. So basically the same thing whether you sell it or just dispense it. So got rid of the definition and got rid of the mention of gasoline service station anywhere in it because I said this is just a gasoline dispensing facility. Revised the definition for independent small business marketer. They've kind of cleaned it up in there somewhere. You can look at it a little closer, and then they took some. Next one was a definition for control of a corporation, and the definition for a refiner, which was mentioned in the definition of an independent small business marketer, and they got the definition directly in there under the definitions. Revised definition for paper type, make it fall more in line with the lease shop. So this definition. Language changes to address conflicts with LSHAP 6C. That was kind of one we mentioned earlier about the tank size and submerged built pipe exemption. That was the main one. One of the main ones there in my eyes. Language changes to match up with definition changes. All this, since it had a service station in the original one mentioned sold a lot. So gasoline. took all the instances of sold and changed them to dispense. Guidance added on the facilities responsibilities for claim exemption. That was, I think it's like three different little parts in there now that really let the regular community get a little clearer idea of what they need to do and us as inspectors to what we should be inspecting. And another note here is the updating, maintaining records, and submitting documentation required by the department. That's what I kind of led up to. Language changes to assure that vapor recovery adapters and vent lines are being properly maintained. That was on the vapor recovery adapter, that's one I mentioned earlier as far as one of the pitfalls there, but the language changed to include the vapor type cap on top of the valves, so that took care of that situation. And then the language added to mentioning the vent line, the pressure valve had to be properly maintained. Language added to clarify the EPA reference test method used for gasoline delivery vessels. The regulation kind of laid out a little bit in a couple little paragraphs on what to do, what should be done with these tanks. It just didn't ever really mention method 27, which is something all gasoline delivery vessels have done yearly anyway to actually go pick up from a permitted gasoline terminal. So they just didn't mention it, so that's been added directly in there and cleaned up. And with it being mentioned, you'd have more guidance on that too, but they don't have they're not too much they have to do except have it done at the right place and everything, and have it on hand in their building as they're filling up the tanks. Language change to ensure that the vapor recovery system was probably retested after it failed test. I mentioned that it did mention doing it after 15 days, but it didn't really have any more clarification on steps we need to take or any notification you have to give us, or it just said to do it. And or any information or guidance on if you can't have it done 15 days, it just said do it. It didn't allow for you to have issues where you couldn't do it. Language added to clarify the EPA reference test method used for stationary gasoline tank. Again, this is test met, the test method has a few paragraphs in there on what to do. And it was, looked like it's similar to method 21, it just didn't mention method 21, so that's been put in the draft. Method 21 being mentioned directly, and then more guidance. And like I said, and ADQ still has their guidance document for anything extra that you might need. Testing timeframes added for verification. That was good too. Like you had like a new equipment come in. Like I said, it's pretty vague in the original one. It just said you had to test it. So we went ahead and pulled some information from the other regulations on testing. You might see some of y'all's permits, but like for new equipment, get done within 60 days and things like that. And proper notification to us that you're testing. Phase in for independent small business marketers, yes. I mentioned that earlier. The first one allowed phase in of a third of the ISBN's facilities per year over a 3-year period. And language has changed, add language to clarify that this applies to an ISBN with at least 3 facilities. So if you have less than 3, you get them done the first year. That was the one where somebody thought, well, he had to hit 100% of his facilities. He had up to a third year to do it. He had 3 years to settle down. That's been updated. You all get with any confusion on that. So summary here. These changes to the state of vapor recovery regulation, the department anticipates a smoother implementation of the rule. In the event of a non-attainment designation in the future, and in turn, a smoother transition back to. I put my contact information up here. If you want to contact me about any state or one stuff, I may have put Tricia's up here for you for everything else.
Yeah.